One team which does have an offense, the Denver Gold, which yesterday became the first of the 6-1s to reach 7-1, coming from behind the second week in a row. Last week they fell down 14-0 in the first quarter. Yesterday they were down 21-0 at halftime to the Pittsburgh Maulers at Pittsburgh. And then in the fourth quarter, after they had gotten to within 21-13, Pittsburgh made the mistake which may have given away the ball game. Leading 21-13, the Maulers attempted to stretch that lead on a fake field goal play. Larry Swider throwing to Tony Lee. Wide open, Lee dropped the football. And after that, Denver was able to come back and tie the ball game. Substitute quarterback Bob Galliano throwing to Leonard Harris. The two-point conversion tied it at 21. Then later, Kevin Williams scored on this 18-yard end-around with 5 minutes left, and that gave Denver a 28-21 lead. They went on to win it 31-21 despite 137 yards rushing by Mike Rozier of Pittsburgh. Denver lost starting quarterback Craig Penrose with a knee injury. Also yesterday, Oklahoma's Outlaws moved to 6-2 on the season with a 2016 win over Hard Luck Washington. Again, the Federals appeared in a position to win the ball game. In the third quarter, Washington was leading 9-6 before only 6,085 fans in RFK Stadium. Reggie Collier, in for the injured Mike Cohen, he ran in from 2 yards out, and Washington now was on top 16-6. But Oklahoma has shown a penchant for coming back. Doug Williams, who passed for 333, hit Al Williams on this 43-yard touchdown pass. You saw the defensive back fall down. That made it 16-13. Then with less than a minute left, Williams threw this 8-yard touchdown pass to Ron Wheeler, and the Outlaws moved to 6-2 with the 20-16 win. They can tie Michigan in the Central Division if the Panthers lose to Birmingham today. L.A. snapped a 5-game home losing streak and got their first win with Steve Young at quarterback, 23-17 in overtime over Memphis. Memphis had taken the lead in the ball game at 17-14 in the fourth quarter on this touchdown run by Bernard Quarles. Quarles making Memphis a 3-point leader. Then, with less than a minute, with only a little more than a minute left, Young appeared to win the game for LA with this touchdown run. It was called back, however, by a holding penalty. So a minute later, with 6 seconds on the clock, Tony Zendejas kicked this field goal that tied the game at 17. Memphis got the ball first in overtime and had the first chance to win it. Pepper Rogers' team tried a trick play, though, and Derek Crawford was intimidated by linebacker Wayman Henderson, gave up the football. David Howard recovered it. Steve Young ran it in from a yard out 2 plays later to win the ball game for the Express. Also yesterday, San Antonio surprisingly shut out Jacksonville 20-0 before 38,000-plus in the Gator Bowl. Quickly, the standings now in the Eastern Conference Atlantic Division. Generals in Philadelphia tied at 6-1. Both teams play today. Southern Division, Birmingham and New Orleans tied at 6-1. Birmingham at Michigan today. New Orleans with Tampa Bay tomorrow night. Central Division, Michigan a half game ahead of Oklahoma. They retain the lead if they can beat tough Birmingham today. Pacific Division, Denver on top alone at 7-1. 2 weeks ago, we saw the first instance of a USFL player jumping to the NFL when Oakland Invaders cornerback Kenny Daniels signed with the Giants. Bigger news of the same stripe this week, Michigan fullback Ken Lacey, one of the key players on that team, signed with the Kansas City Chiefs, a contract which will put him in action in a Chiefs uniform this fall. Lacey explained to us his rationale for jumping to the NFL this way.
Basically, I've been negotiating with the Kansas City Chiefs for a couple of months now, I guess since back in March, along with several other NFL teams. This is my final year on my contract with the Panthers, and the offer that they made me wasn't anywhere even close to Kansas City, and that was a business decision on my part, and I felt that was the best thing for me to do for me and my family at the time.
It was also reported this week that New Orleans linebacker Marcus Marek is talking with the Cincinnati Bengals back in the state where he played college football, Ohio. Marek says he's keeping his options open for now.
There's been a lot of extensive talks through my agent in Cincinnati, and he's been keeping me abreast of it. But I think, you know, we've been talking with Randy, too, Randy Fataha, our president. And so it's hard to say right now, but it looks good that something could happen by the end of this week as far as whether I'll be in New Orleans.
Another player rumored headed for the NFL, Washington running back Craig James, who Thursday apparently asked for and was given his release by the Federals. James, his twice injured knees and his heavy contract then cleared waivers through the entire USFL. He concedes he has initiated discussions with the New England Patriots of the NFL, the team which could reunite him with his former college coach at SMU, Ron Meyer. And this final piece of news, a New York Times sports banner headline this morning introduced a story which states that the USFL's long-range planning committee will decide to begin playing a fall schedule in 1987, the season which coincides with the negotiation of a new television contract for the rival NFL. USFL Commissioner Chet Simmons reached at home this morning, told me that indeed the 1987 fall schedule is one of the options which the league's owners are considering, that there are some owners who are in favor of playing a fall schedule, but that no decision has yet been made on that option.